Now I'll take some questions from the audience if I could see you. I see somebody here holding up his hand. If we could have a mic down here, please identify yourself and keep questions succinct if possible. Is there a mic? I'm not sure if this one works, but you're welcome to it. No. C'est notre faute. C'est pour monsieur. Yes. Thank you.
Merci, monsieur Leichoubi, donc académicien, ancien ministre algérien. Le spatial, vous l'avez laissé entendre, est un marqueur de puissance. Alors comment, selon vous, appréhendez-vous l'émergence des nouveaux pays en termes de concurrence et de bouleversement des hiérarchies, notamment la Chine, l'Inde, etc. Ma deuxième question, le spatial, outre ses capacités militaires, c'est aussi un support de l'intelligence et donc une transmission des données, télécommunications, etc., pose pour un certain nombre de pays la question de la souveraineté et de l'autonomie de développement, et sous le même angle et dans la même préoccupation, pose pour les citoyens les grandes questions d'éthique et de préservation des éléments personnels. À telle enceinte que nous avons vu des grandes puissances s'accuser mutuellement d'interférence à travers le numérique pour influencer. Et j'aimerais là avoir votre position sur cette deuxième question d'éthique.
Good question.
Ok, je vais vous répondre en français si vous voulez. La première question, donc je vous ai dit qu'il y avait six grandes puissances spatiales. Aujourd'hui, moi je considère que les États-Unis sont numéro un. En numéro deux, on a ex aequo la Chine pour des raisons quantitatives, 30 ou 35 lancements dans l'année. L'Europe pour des raisons qualitatives, nous avons des satellites à la pointe de ce qui se fait. On a lancé il y a quelques jours Bepi Colombo qui est parti pour un voyage de 7 ans vers la planète Mercure et c'est une sonde à 2 milliards d'euros qui est à l'extrême limite de ce qu'on sait faire en matière technologique. Donc États-Unis, Chine et Europe et puis Russie, Japon, Inde. Et nous avons maintenant beaucoup de nouvelles puissances spatiales. L'Algérie en étude, vous le savez, avec les satellites Alat et quelques autres, parce que le ticket d'accès à l'espace a diminué. Et donc on peut avoir de plus en plus de pays qui font du spatial. Et ça, je pense que c'est très bien parce que ça conduit à diffuser les usages de l'espace pour l'aménagement du territoire, pour l'agriculture et pour tout ce qu'on peut imaginer. Donc c'est la première question. Je vois avec beaucoup de sympathie de plus en plus de pays faire du spatial. La deuxième question sur les enjeux de souveraineté, je dirais que le spatial, il faut légiférer là aussi comme dans les autres domaines. Et les autres domaines, vous avez parlé des GAFA, de l'Internet, des choses comme ça, mais sur le spatial, on a à peu près les mêmes problématiques. Donc il y a un bureau des Nations Unies à Vienne qui travaille sur ces sujets. Il faut faire attention parce que c'est vrai qu'avec un satellite d'observation, vous pouvez aller observer ce qui se passe chez le voisin, ça doit être encadré. Vous pouvez écouter ce qui se passe là aussi, ça doit être encadré. Alors bien sûr, il y a des systèmes militaires, il y a des systèmes civils, mais il peut y avoir aussi des entités privées qui font ce que jusqu'alors était réservé à des entités gouvernementales. Donc on légifère, on fait attention. C'est un système qui se développe, comme tous les systèmes qui se développent, il y aura un pas en avant, parfois un pas en arrière, mais je pense que globalement, ça fait partie du développement du progrès technologique.
We have a question in the front row here, if we could have a mic. There. Mr. Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Fujisaki from Japan. I have a question. I think the mainstream of thinking now on space exploration is first go to Gateway that Trump administration is proposing, and then to Moon again, and then to Mars. That is the sort of mainstream way. I would like to know if there's any relations, do you think, between this low orbit gateway around Moon and landing on the moon, meaning how much you contribute to Gateway, would that be related to the possibility of going to moon as well? If you are not trying to send European astronaut by yourselves, or and still you'll be using American apparatus or Russian rocket, do you think that in order to participate in Gateway will secure your possibility of trying to have your astronauts on the rocket? Am I clear?
Yes, I think that all what is related to human flights should be made in cooperation, because the price is very, very high. If you speak about the International Space Station, which is the biggest cooperative technology project today worldwide, it's more than $100 billion which are in orbit. And it is why the Gateway now, it is considered that it should be developed in cooperation with the historic partners of the space station, US, Russia, Europe, Canada, Japan, and with perhaps some other ones, I say. But the idea is to have a kind of mid-sized space station in orbit on the Earth and on the Moon, and low Earth orbit, but going to the Moon, with perhaps a private initiative going from the space station to the Moon, because the government wants to keep a part of the money available to go in the future to Mars, first with robots, and in perhaps 20 or 25 years with astronauts. But this is the policy today which is implemented, but as I said in my introduction, it is something which is new, because it followed the appointment of the new administrator of NASA, and the US are shaping now the post-International Space Station world policy, and we will see the future. But about the question, should we have an autonomous capacity either in Japan or in Europe to send astronauts, in fact, we are in a cooperative project, and it has been decided that the transportation should be for the Russians or the US, and we provide laboratories as you do with VHTV, as we did in the past with VITV, so it's a joint project.
We have time for one last brief question over here.
Thank you very much, Peter Jankovic, former member of the Austrian government. Jean-Yves, there are so many fantastic developments in space which we have seen now in this CNES movie, but there are of course also many dangers threatening for further developments in space, and two of those are space debris, the increasing number of objects floating in space and threatening space objects like the International Space Station. And the second one is the question, how are we going to regulate space traffic? Are there any plans for space traffic management? And what authorities do you see who could address these problems?
I think that it is an excellent question. And as you know, Peter, a lot of people are working today on this issue, because in fact, there are two points. The first one, the debris. And in the past, when satellites were launched, nobody took care about the debris until a few years ago, when people realized that even a very, very small debris at 8 kilometers per second, it can make a lot of damages on satellites. And so now there is a regulation. It means that in the past, when you had to separate a satellite from a launcher, you had a kind of explosive device which created a cloud of debris, and now you have just a system with no debris. So this point is the first point. We don't create any more debris And so I think that this point is behind us. But another one which is much more interesting is that there are more and more projects using, in particular, constellations of satellites. And it is clear that if you launch a constellation of 4,000 satellites to put internet everywhere on the Earth, this is a project by SpaceX or Google, managing these 4,000 satellites will be quite difficult, and there are now some regulations which are implemented to avoid collisions between satellites. But we are going to have the same regulation as we have for airliners. We are just at the beginning of the satellites, and we were at the beginning of airliners, let us say, in the year something as 100 years ago. And so now, if the number of satellites is going to increase, we are going to have, as you say, the space traffic management, because managing 4,000 satellites or perhaps 10,000 satellites in low Earth orbit, it is not so easy. And so it means that satellites will have some rules to comply with and to be sure that they will not collide, and so that it will be done in perfect harmony.